So having the commercial side of it is important, because getting the message across of what's available for local businesses will benefit those local businesses, which in turn benefits the total community.
Commercial radio, of course, relies entirely on sponsorship and advertising to pay the bills and to pay the wages of those of us who work there. Sponsorship plays a very great part in the programming. You can't sponsor the news, though, so the news, I always say, is the last bastion of public service broadcasting, even on commercial radio.
Radio Wave Report with
Good afternoon. The Cleveland's headmaster, who's leading a campaign to stop a special school from opening up in the same grounds as his primary school, says he's not convinced education bosses understand the problem. Details next. It's 4 o'clock.
It's 4 o'clock.
That is you, aren't I?
The government got a jingle there, then. You very nearly didn't get one.
I have to remember to be commercially minded in the way I write news, so that we're appealing to the people who will listen to the adverts, who will go out and buy washing powder on the strength of hearing that advert. And of course, you've got to remember to tailor-make the news to suit that audience.
Commercial considerations are not the only restrictions faced by radio stations and individual presenters.
I think any radio station that's run under the guise of the Radio Authority or the BBC faces restrictions. That's only natural, and they're there for everybody's protection as well. University radio is great because it's free, you can do what you want. I remember university radio well.
The music policy is basically play what you want, really, within certain guidelines. We've got the Radio Authority guidelines to work to, and we've also got station policy. Obviously, nobody takes a blind bit of notice of that and plays whatever they like. We also do operate a bit of playlisting, where the head of music gets his chance to gain a bit of power and choose some of the records for the presenters to play. It gives the station an overall feel for particular times of the day.
Student radio is a lot more relaxing than commercial radio. It's a lot more...
And you get the opportunity to do what you really want to do. There's no one saying you have to do this, apart from Roger, but then we can always beat him up.
So what will having a permanent FM licence mean for Radio Bailrigg?
Well, I hope having an FM licence won't change the type of station it is too much. I hope it won't make it too professional, because after all, we're here to serve the students, and we're all students ourselves. We're doing a degree at the same time as doing these radio shows, and so I hope we won't lose an atmosphere whereby it's friendly, whereby it's relaxed, and whereby you're not too restricted on what you can say or what you can play or what you can do.
The FM license is good for morale around the station. When we were on medium wave, everybody was quite downhearted and they didn't seem to give two hoots about what was going on. Now that FM's come along, everybody's got excited, they've got involved with the station again. I don't think anything about the station and its plans have changed. It's just the fact that we can go ahead and do it now, whereas before we couldn't.
Well, yeah. I tell you, it's going to make them a lot harder apart from anything else. All this hard work. Yeah, we've been doing our jingles and stuff. So, yeah, we're trying to get more professional.
Organised.
Sarah, Philippa and Claire, Half a Cider and They're Anybody's.
I think it's going to get more recognition than it has at the moment.
Yeah, that's hot.
And more listeners. And we're going to be able to use it as a better medium for things that are going on in general on the campus, aren't we?
Yeah.
I would say it's not all glamorous radio, Bailrigg. You get these shit jobs like this as well.
Anthony, if you could hold it.
Oh, why don't I
hold it? Go on, Anthony!
Anthony!
If you do hold it towards me,
I'm
on a wide angle, it'll be really sort of very prominent. You know, so
right.
It'll give the 87.7 a bit of a plug. But up towards me, really up to, yeah, read it. Long arms. Long arms, Joe. Probably about there somewhere.
Okay.
Just hang on.
Just
can't
feel
that's it, that's the one. Okay. That's fine, we'll have two of that as well. You can just tilt it that way or touch it as well. Other way. That way.
Oh,
that's it. Maybe they'll lean on that way. Okay. Right, crew, we're off again.
And you're station director in the year that this is launched, so this is quite special for you. So that's 25 years down the line, you'll be able to look back at how Bailrigg FM is still doing and say, yeah, you were there at the start.
Well, you never know, we might be on digital by then, but if we can move on to a different frequency every 25 years, we started off on medium wave, we're on FM now, it might be digital in another 25 years' time, but obviously starting us off, it's a great thrill for me and something to put on my CV.
That's great.
Okay.
Yes. Karen, can you just turn to your left a little bit? That's great.
All you can see is the back of his head.
Broadcast in English. Hello and welcome to your brand new radio station, Bailrigg FM. It's 6 p.m. on Friday, the 19th of January, 1995. Bang.
1995?
1996.
I'll have to use
that
one on tape.
Go on. That could have been
fun.
Go on. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. That'll do. Felch on my script. I said. I'm not going to do Felch. You've got to say Felch.
We're all shouting. It's all going, isn't it? It's all going.
Oh, I don't mind.
Board.
Are we
going to
have a big countdown to the start?
No, we're not. Can you hear the pips?
Hello, good evening, and welcome to your brand new radio station, Bailrigg FM. It's 6 p.m. on Friday, the 19th of January, 1996. Bailrigg FM starting officially with the Rolling Stones and Brown Sugar, just as Radio Bailrigg launched within 1971.